Okay, good morning, everybody. It's a great pleasure to start this day with a presentation on leveraging sport events for sport development. And at this point in time, I would like to acknowledge my collaborators on this project. And please, I would like you to stand up, Laura Meisner, Lawrence Chalip, and Christine Green, so that everybody can see who you are and that difficult questions can also go towards you. Where's Laura? Okay. I definitely could not have pulled this off without their assistance. I mean, this has really been a team effort all along, and I want to thank you here publicly for your collaboration and making this happen. All right, so the Canadian sports policy. We know that events play an important role in the Canadian sports policy for a variety of reasons, be it economic, tourism, or social impact. But really, what better tools than a sport event to stimulate sport participation? After all, sport is at the core of sport events. So this is a general statement and an important statement of the Canadian sports policy, but they also have a specific objectives as it relates to sport events and sport participation. So one of the objectives is, and I quote, to strengthen the sport excellence and sport development impacts of bidding, hosting the Canadian Games, and targeted international sport events. So through that policy objective, they really appreciate that bidding for games may make the link to sport participation. So this assumption is based on the so-called trickle-down effect or demonstration effect, or others call it inspiration effect. However, data on this matter are inconclusive. What is known, however, is that sport participation is not merely raised by hosting the event itself. Just by merely hosting the event is not going to raise sport participation. But what is needed is to plan. And that brings us to the concept of event leveraging. So event leveraging really implies that strategic planning will take place in order to create desired outcomes. And obviously, that planning needs to start way in advance of hosting the event. So strategic plans are developed, they need to be implemented to create desired outcomes. And in this particular case, we're focusing on sport participation outcomes. So how did we go about to set up this research? The first phase was an evaluation phase. This is where we evaluated sport participation outcomes of two past events. And the two events that we took into consideration were the 2005 Pan American Junior Athletic Championships and the 2005 Canadian National Figure Skating Championships. And we use document analysis and media analysis, as well as retrospective interviews with key stakeholders, such as people from the local organizing committee, local sports organizations, facility managers, and athletes, to ask about their perceptions and evaluation of sport participation outcomes. And we conducted these interviews 6 years after the fact, and we thought that this time was long enough to really see if there was any sustainable potential impact of sport participation outcomes. In phase two, which we called the planning phase, a task force was created to consider challenges and prospects for leveraging events for sport development. So the panel of experts that was comprised of 12 practitioners and academics from a variety of organizations that would or could be involved or benefit from sport participation outcomes, such as representative from sports policy, event management, facility management, coaching, tourism, marketing, education, and community development. So experts from these fields were brought together, and through brainstorming, we collected data and actually developed a model for sport event leveraging, which I will present later. Finally, the implementation phase. This was the phase where we implemented our findings and we used the 2013 International Children's Games as the event to be leveraged. And we focused on two specific sports, track and field and gymnastics. Now, the International Children's Games is a multi-sport event that included 8 different sports, and it's an event that is for 12 to 15-year-old youth. So we picked specifically athletic and gymnastics as the sports to be stimulated. What we did here is we organized a workshop with people from these communities 6 months prior to the event, and we developed an action plan for leveraging, specifically for sport participation. Then, informally, we followed up with these organizations. During the event, we did participant observations and also some casual meetings. 1 month after the event, we followed up with another workshop to evaluate what the outcomes were, or primary preliminary outcomes, and 1 year after, we did retrospective interviews. So, what were the findings? From phase one, the evaluation phase, we found that sport events are unlikely in and of themselves to generate increases in sport participation, and that was confirmed. And key stakeholders of sports events supported the idea, yeah, that's a good idea to increase sport participation through events, but they assumed that this would happen automatically. Just by the mere fact of creating awareness, that will stimulate sport participation. And obviously, we did not find that as a result. So we found no evidence also for any defined strategic intentions or plans to leverage events for fostering sport participation. It was more occasionally that we saw some initiatives. And for instance, for the Pan American Junior Athletic Championships, intentionally a coaching clinic was hosted and a new stadium was built. And the coaching clinic was not successful because it was barely attended, but the new stadium, we can say, generated some positive outcomes when it comes to sport participation, but it was specifically for those already involved in sports. So the people that were already in track and field benefited highly from the new stadium as well as the new equipment. But also the new stadium was also able to help other sports such as soccer or football. But definitely it benefited those already in sport. When we look at the actual number of membership, there was only one track and field club at the time in Windsor, and you see on the slide there that the 1 year after the event in 2006, there was indeed an increase in members, but then we had a huge drop the year thereafter, and one of the reasons is that because of hosting the Pan American Championships, the head coach of the club had a very important role in the hosting of the event, and he gained a lot of personal knowledge of staging international events, so his personal knowledge increased dramatically. And his increase in human capital made him leave the club because he was hired somewhere else, and so now the club was without their head coach, and that may partly explain the drop in members there. When we look at the Skate Canada events, yes, they did some actions, like they went to schools, they had some educational program, they did some demonstrations during the event, and both events also distributed flyers during the event. But as you see through my question marks, we have absolutely no ideas if these tactics created any increase in sport participation. And really, when we talk to the people from Sports Canada, from Skate Canada, or the people that were involved with skating in the London area where the event was hosted, there was no increase in participation noted. The second phase, the planning phase, is where we developed this model for sport leveraging. And this was created through the panel of experts. And it revealed factors that can enhance or hinder leveraging strategies and tactics. And it illustrates that sport events can be leveraged to enhance sport participation if the necessary alliances among sports organizations, event organizers, and non-sport stakeholders are forged to integrate each event into the marketing mix of sport organizations. So the model consists of three elements. There is the context, obviously, the culture, opinions and attitudes, systems and structures. And then there is three types of organizations identified with a stake in the leveraging process, and this can be the event, the sport, or non-sport entities. And finally, the resources needed. You need human resources, physical, and knowledge. So the center of the model really reflects the core of the leveraging effort, which is the sport participation and development goals. And that should really be the starting point of any leveraging approach for sport participation. If there are no goals defined by entities that really want to obtain these outcomes, it's just not going to happen. The final stage then, in phase three, the implementation phase, here we found that, first of all, sports organizations lack the necessary skills and resources to take advantage of locally hosted events to build participation in their sport. So they don't have the necessary skills and resources. Secondly, we found that local sports organizations have a set of standard operating procedures for the recruitment and retention, but they do it always in a similar way, and they do it their way, and don't really start think outside of the box. But we also found that events can catalyze the attention of local, of administrators of local sports organizations. So they understand that there may be something with events that can benefit to build their sport. So in phase three, the sports communities, athletics and gymnastics, were unable to implement the solid ideas and initiatives that had been developed in the 6 months prior to the event. So for instance, for athletics, we had a 10-point action, we developed a 10-point action plan. But only some isolated tactics were implemented. For instance, they were handing out some posters in schools prior, and they handed out some flyers during the event. And that was all they did. And we developed a whole 10-point action point. So challenges to implement the developed strategies and tactics seem to be a lack of human resources, that was particularly the case for athletics, and a lack of community to enable collaborative actions among a variety of clubs. And that was the case of gymnastics, because gymnastics had multiple clubs in the community, and it was very difficult to make them work together to create positive outcomes for gymnastics. So 1 year after the event, the stakeholders revealed some evidence for the inspiration effect, but again, it was for those already in sport. And they said that it was specifically the international context of the event that really was inspiring for those already in sport. Because remember, this is an event 12 to 15-year-olds. They do not have the opportunity to compete internationally very often. And that really, they thought that was fantastic and inspired the participants, but also others who watched this. So, from a practical standpoint, formulation and implementation of strategies and tactics and measurements need to be put into place at the outset of an event. This will enable the efficacy of strategies and tactics to be benchmarked and assessed. The responsibility needs to be assigned to a well-defined entity. So we need somebody that takes the responsibility for carrying out this leveraging strategy. These requirements can be added to the policies for hosting events, be it at the federal level, for example, the federal policy for hosting international sport events, the provincial or the local levels for smaller sized events. Future research or the findings of this study suggest that sports organizations' capacity to market themselves to participants is a prerequisite for effective leveraging of events to build participation. And that capacity building must take place well in advance of an event so that the necessary skills and resources are adequately established. Future research should examine how local sports organizations can build that capacity and to what degree adding an event into a well-developed marketing strategy will benefit local sports organizations to build participation in their sport. And that concludes my presentation.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Marijke. That was very actually riveting. For someone involved in the sport my whole life, I can't believe that international events don't automatically generate participation. So very, very interesting, obviously.
Merci beaucoup pour votre présentation. Nous allons maintenant aller aux commentaires des membres qui sont assis à l'avant.
I'd like to invite the three of you to make your comments from the table microphone, and after that we'll open it up to you here in the room. So we'll start with Stephen Trainer from the Canadian Sport Tourism Alliance, as well as Sport Matters. Go ahead, Stephen.
Well, thank you very much, Sylvie. First of all, I want to say thanks to CERC and Sport Canada for hosting an excellent conference. Thanks to everybody for coming. On behalf of the Canadian Sport Tourism Alliance, I would like to say thank you for all those that came from outside the city. You're engaging right now in sport tourism, so thank you very much for doing that. I just want to thank the four authors of this work. I think it was, I'll just give my overall thoughts on the paper. I was very happy to see work and thought on this topic. In addition to working with the Canadian Sport Tourism Alliance, I'm also affiliated with Sport Matters Group, and Sport for Development and making a difference through sport for more than just sport is something that's very important to me and the organizations I represent. I know that, as I'm dating myself, but I know that a while ago, CERC hosted a speaker several years back from Scotland that actually came to Canada and talked about the whole idea of sport participation and Olympic Games or Commonwealth Games in the lead up to Glasgow. And, you know, that person had similar things to say about, you know, if you're not using things intentionally in order with a strategy and a tactic in order to engage people, it's not going to happen just by itself. There are some latent functions that you benefit from hosting games, infrastructure, the list goes on and on, but intentionality is needed. There were some concepts in the paper that I feel I can agree with. Like I said, intentional sport, and we're seeing this in many different areas. I know that there's some members of Sport Canada, Joanne Kay, I don't know if you're here right now, I saw you on the list. You were involved with an organization I was involved with, the Working Together Initiative, that looked at using sport for more than just sport, the intentional use of sport and physical activity to make a change in a number of different public policy areas, justice, reducing youth crime, substance abuse, et cetera, et cetera. So I just want to reassure you that the sector has never been more aware of what's going on out there and never been in more need of engaging with the academic community. And I'll get to that. So in terms of, I also think that coordination between sectors of sport is key to making events incubators of development, city tourism and government, sport groups at all levels, sport councils. Paul Dribello, you're in attendance right now. You guys have an important part to play. Local groups, NSOs and PSOs, and funders, foundations, Sport Canada, etc. These are all stakeholders that have to work together in order to make a real difference. My concerns with the paper, just because we have a very smart group here and I'm representing the practitioner side, I just want to bring up these things to think about when evaluating this type of work. I think the work is important. I think it's good. But I would be concerned if we oversimplify concluded events do not equal development. I think that's making the same mistake that people on the sports side say, well, if you build it, they will come. So let's not oversimplify what we saw in this paper. Let's take it on the merit that we see. Also, sample size and the sports chosen and the level of events chosen, I would say that might not be the greatest events that would induce participation. And, you know, two events, it's a $5 billion industry, sport events and sport tourism. So two events is a very small sample size. The sport tourism field is a champion of many accessible templates that are accessible to the sport community, and I think that this research might lead to the development of a sport development template if there's interested parties. And we all know that Sport Canada has done a lot in terms of sport tourism economic assessment models. They've played their part in terms of actively making something that's accessible and easy to use. And finally, my recommendations is, awareness is good, but how do we make it happen? If it's mandatory for funding, what part of the event will suffer? And it's fine to say that local sport people are over, you know, they don't have the capacity, but how are we going to make life better for them? How do we make it accessible for academics to be reachable and for people to know how to use these checklists? And then finally, increasing planning and partnering, I think, is very important. It's not enough to say to talk about the local sports groups and their capacity. And I would also say with 6 months of planning, a lot of these international events, 2 years, 3 years in advance, you got to get the idea of sport development and that it's a priority from the very get-go, and not only in terms of funding, but in terms of the overall planning process. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Stephen. Alors maintenant, on va passer à la perspective académique avec Milena Parent de l'Université d'Ottawa.
Merci, Sylvie. Merci à Sport Canada et à CIRC de m'avoir invité. And thank you to the research team, Marek and company, for your study. It relieves me and it saddens me at the same time in terms of the findings that you had. I know the Canadian Sport Policy PIM group is tired of me of hearing me say that I don't want to see another mention of sport participation as being the outcome of a sporting event, because it doesn't automatically happen, that you need to actually leverage, you need to plan for that. So I think that's a key, and it's unfortunate that you found that as well, I find, but it also confirms what I've been thinking and what I've seen in other areas. I also found it interesting that there's no partnerships that were activated, even despite your efforts and despite your actions. It's interesting because it brings to the point of something that we were discussing last night as well, of there's a few more studies now that are finding that local sport organizations and their capacity, they have a way of doing things. They don't want to change their way of doing things. They do not want to increase their capacity for whatever reason. And they will either borrow that capacity from somewhere else or pay someone else to do those things, whether it's paying or asking parents to pay for this increased capacity so that they don't need to do it themselves. And so I think there's really some reflection that needs to be done around that. Despite all these calls for increasing capacity at the local sport organization, why are they not increasing? Why do they have their way of doing things and not want to change? And also what can be done if something should be done as well at that level. Maybe it's another level. Maybe it's another organization that needs to be included in that kind of capacity increase. Could there be, one of the questions I was wondering is whether the sports structure, so figure skating or track and field or gymnastics, whether the sports structure itself, each one, has an impact in terms of the degree of engagement, the degree of awareness, and the move from awareness into sport participation and sport development, whether there are differences between the sports. Could some sports be easier to do this with, as opposed to others like gymnastics or figure skating that are very club-based and very fragmented in that sense, at the local level at least. I'm also kind of following up on what Stephen was saying, that maybe it's not sport participation we need to be talking about, it's sport development in terms of outcomes and legacies of sport events. That the development, especially moving from just an intro to sport and keeping that person in the sport and moving them up into an elite level, maybe that's what we need to be focusing on instead of increasing the new numbers of participants, because local sport organizations don't seem to be interested in doing that, or at least not actively doing it. And finally, I think one of the things is that concept of barriers. Could barriers be so strong that they supersede anything else? And what could be done to remove those barriers or to facilitate that process? I don't have the answer to that. I'm kind of posing it out there. Maybe someone else does, or maybe it's a research that needs to be done as well.
Merci beaucoup, Milena. And now we'll end this part of our panel discussion with the Sport Canada perspective with Lane McAdam.
Merci, Sylvie. Merci de votre invitation, and thanks for joining us here today for what's going to be, I think, a fun day of kind of learning and sharing. Mon rôle à Sport Canada, c'est de s'occuper de nos programmes d'haute performance. So I come at this kind of more from a high-performance perspective. However, I did spend 10 years as CEO of the Canada Games Council, so I kind of understand the impact of an event in a community. And I guess while I would share the views that there's kind of good news, bad news here, I think there are examples where we can take some hope in terms of being more deliberate about the planning for the impact of these large events in terms of greater participation in communities. You'll know that the importance of events in Canada has been significant. If you look at, for instance, 10 days ago, Governor General announced the Year of Sport next year. Guess what? It features three big sport events, Canada Games in Prince George, the FIFA World Cup here and across Canada, and as well as the Pan Am, Para Pan Am Games. So these are significant events in our Canadian sport landscape that we kind of tie a lot of resources, both human and financial, to. And to the extent that we can kind of improve our outcomes in terms of legacy impact is obviously an objective of policymakers and sport organizations and local communities that, you know, have to live with the impact of these events after the events. You'll know in Canada, you know, our sport system is driven significantly by hosting major events. You look at the Montreal Games and the impact that that had on some early policy development around the athlete assistance program, around, you know, having a first minister of sport that occurred in that era. In Calgary in 88, when we hosted the Olympics, we had the best ever program, which was really kind of the early stages of an own the podium type concept around targeted investment in our high performance programs, and that led to increased investments both on winter and the summer side. And certainly after Vancouver, with the advent of Own the Podium, significant legacies around high performance programming resulted from that. But we made some mistakes, and I think we're going to try and learn from those as well. But the notion that if you host it and they will come, I think as evidenced by Marika's work, I think really bears out the rhetoric that a lot of countries, and certainly in Canada, we use that rhetoric as well, that you host the event and you're going to see an automatic blip in participation rates. Is obviously the research does not bear that out. But I think the good news is that if you host it and you plan it, they might come and they might sign up. And I think that's really the key message here and the notion of leveraging. But so central to that notion of leveraging is planning. And as Marika outlined, this is not a short-term, you know, back of a napkin kind of approach. It takes time to plan in advance, and it also takes time post-event to understand the implications and the impact. We're seeing London Olympics 2012. We're still seeing, it's still early days around some of the impact of some of the planning and preparations there, and those games are regarded as probably the best plan in terms of legacy considerations, not strictly around sport participation, but around urban regeneration, social economic impact, etc. So it's still early days, but I think we're seeing signs that the franchise holders are actually beginning to sort of incorporate these kinds of considerations into their bidding and staging requirements. So the conclusion is, I think there's the bad news is that, again, if you host it and they'll sign up, I think that notion is probably not accurate. And as Marika outlined, awareness is, and the inspirational effect is important, but it's not really the trigger for action and a call to action necessarily. So, and again, you're often preaching to the converted. So it's the those that are already involved want to get better, as opposed to growing the participation rates of those in the community. The good news, I think, is again with deliberate, intentional planning, as Stephen pointed out, there are opportunities for sport participation. And again, I think as Marika points out, the key aspects of that include partnerships, making sure that those linkages occur, not just as the franchise holder kind of waltzes into town and stages the event and disappears, but you've got to build those bridges with those that are left in the community afterwards. The systems, the structures, obviously the capacity, as I mentioned, resources, both human and financial and infrastructure, when we see large-scale events like the Pan Am, Para Pan Am Games, significant infrastructure left behind in the community. And we need to understand the barriers, as Marika's pointed out. So it's not easy work, but I think to the extent that there's more critical evaluation of this, there'll be hopefully more impact on kind of future policies around ensuring that there's better requirements for hosting and therefore better outcomes in terms of the direct link. So the practical implications here is, you know, we need to learn from our mistakes, and I'll speak very briefly about the Pan Am Games, Para Pan Am Games in Toronto. We've learned from some, I guess, what I would describe as missed opportunities from Vancouver around legacy planning around infrastructure, and we've incorporated a lot of that into the three key legacy facilities that will result in that are being built for the Pan Am Games. That includes a new velodrome in Canada, Canada's only enclosed velodrome in Milton, a new brand new aquatic, anybody seen a new aquatic facility in Scarborough? It's a game changer. A great facility. Two 50-meter pools, dive tank, gymnasium. Incredible mix of use between the university, the community, and high-performance users. So we built that right in. And the last piece is a new athletic stadium at York University. So I think we've learned a lot from those. Again, it's probably more from a high-performance perspective from Sport Canada's end, but there's no question that there's an impact on the local community as well. So I guess the other lesson is, you know, don't listen to your rhetoric, because as Marika's pointed out, these kind of notional, and as Sylvie identified as someone who's been involved with Olympics her entire life, you know, she was a little bummed out hearing that, you know, those linkages don't necessarily exist. So I think we need to be careful about how we tout those relationships when the evidence really is not there. And I guess the last message is plan, and make someone accountable. Those are really the keys to improving the outcomes in terms of those linkages between having a big event at a national, international, even a local level, and understanding the implications for the downstream impact on trying to bring more kids and young people into the sport. Thank you.
Merci beaucoup. Thank you, Lane. C'est temps maintenant pour vos questions, vos commentaires. We have volunteers in gray T-shirts with microphones. And if you want to ask a question, clarification on the research, comment on what you heard from our discussant panel members, we have a question here. Let's go with Nancy online. Nancy's got an online question, so we can bring the question. Our webinar audience is getting involved. Nancy, go ahead.
Thank you. So these questions are on behalf of our online audience here. So they're wondering if there's a link between media coverage and increased sport participation from events.
So there is no direct link. I mean, even when the media reports positively about the event, it is this assumption that through the media you create awareness. So that awareness, that idea of awareness, is that the media takes it on and then spreads the word and creates that awareness for the event. So the media plays an important role in creating awareness for the event, but that in itself is not helpful. That doesn't mean that the media cannot strategically used to develop a campaign, for example, by showcasting local athletes that will participate and bring life stories out way before, so to grasp that interest on how you get involved in that sport. So I think the way the media handles it now doesn't do it right, but I think you can craft it and integrate the media in your planning to get the right stories out and provide the right information how you can stimulate sport participation.
Thank you. Anything else from the online audience, Nancy?
I do actually have another question, too.
Go ahead.
And it kind of gets to part of what you're saying about the local community. So they were wondering if there could be a link between increased participation and the outcomes of who won. So if it was someone local, does that make a difference to the increased participation?
We don't have that in our findings.
I'm just wondering.
Yeah. I mean, the inspiration could be very short term. There could be some spike immediately after, but there is no evidence that there would be any lasting effect from having a role model out there. But that doesn't mean that you cannot start using that role model again in your post-event planning. So on itself, it may spike it just very shortly after, but it will not sustain.
Lane, you want to add something to that?
Just, I guess I would agree generally, but I think there are examples perhaps where extensive coverage of an activity, and I'll use two examples. One, if you looked at the women's hockey participation for the first time in Nagano at the Olympic level, there was a significant increase in women's hockey registrations in Canada. That facts are there. And similarly, when we hosted the U20 Women's Soccer Championship several years ago, soccer registration for girls is the trend is continuing. So, but I think that the difference there is in both cases, there was organizations in place, there was capacity, there was local linkages, and they were able to actually take on board that interest. And it's not exclusively related to those events, but certainly it had an impact in my view.
Thank you, Lane. I know we have some questions. On a des questions ici.
Morning. My name is Kathleen Miller. I was interested in the legacy aspect and the research from turning the aspect backwards. In other words, studying if there were follow-up projects and if they were successful rather than what sports did leading up to an event. I've seen over the last 35 years that because the games or events are volunteer-based, there tends to be a tremendous burnout on the people's part who would organize future structures, get people involved. It's not an athlete-led progress. It's a volunteer administrator and local structure process that continues it. If we're going to have the capacity, whether facilities are part of the legacy or not, the human resources, organizing them, does that make it a lasting effect? Whether it's a small sport or a big sport, whether it is club-based or not, I think the research is really interesting because that's exactly what I've found in what I've had to deal with in sport over the years, that we have a big event, everybody gets burnt out, the volunteers are gone, no one continues on. So in terms of research in the future, it would be interesting if after a major event, with a structured follow-up to using the games, whether participation actually grew or not. Thank you.
Any reaction to that? Or Marika, go ahead.
So, well, first of all, I think we kind of agree that the local organizing committee itself is probably not the best person or entity to take on this leveraging idea. You definitely need an entity that stays after the event. And you're definitely right on. I mean, human resource, or the lack of thereof, is really a major component of the lack of capacity to carry out the plans and the whole leveraging strategy. And definitely when you can build that human resource, or you can create an entity, a group of people that is just responsible for that component and is not responsible for carrying out any other parts of an event, so they become fully responsible. If you have a plan, there is pre-planning, you have the implementation, and then obviously you have post strategies and tactics, and you need to evaluate your outcomes. So if you have created ideas through the event, then you need to make sure that whatever happened there, you can measure it when people are attracted to come to the local organizing, to the local sports organizations, that you track that, right? So there needs to be a part of post-evaluation. So post strategies, but also evaluating the outcomes. But I think one of the avenues is that there needs to be a separate entity of people who want to take that on. And I think what is key in there is that this group of people really believe in sport development goals. That is going to be the primary key driver. Do they believe in what they want to obtain?
All right, time for one last question, if there is one. If not, we'll move on. Est-ce qu'il y a une dernière question? Oui, ici en arrière.
There's an age-old question, I think, here, which is, you know, how many sport developers does it take to change a light bulb? And the answer is only one, but it has to want to change. And really, we find the same thing here, that the challenge we face is that, in fact, in order to bring in more participation, you have to have unused capacity. If you have unused capacity, you have inefficient management. So at any point in time, the sport organizations are in a position of setting an equilibrium that's managerial efficient and marketing efficient. And so one of the things you have to do is to shift that efficiency point so that, in fact, you have created unused capacity. And that's something we haven't done very well. I mean, one of the reasons they're resistant is because if you bring in the capacity, you bring in more athletes while you still have the same number of coaches, your athlete-to-coach ratio goes up, then there are inefficiencies in your coaching that may be a problem, especially with reference to service to the elite athletes, where the status comes. If you don't have enough facility space, you have the problem of needing more facility space, but then you're using your facilities efficiently. The idea of creating new facilities as a way of building participation may be actually questionable, in so much as basically you're shifting the supply curve leftward, and we know what happens then. We actually raise prices and reduce quantity consumed. And finally, you know, there's the secondary kinds of things you need, your officials, your administrators, and the like. So I think the point being that one of the reasons that the sport organizations are reticent to start looking at large increases in participation is, in fact, they're at a point of efficiency now. Otherwise, they're badly managed to start with. And so they have to, you have to actually change that that capacity with reference to building new efficiencies into the system so that they actually can absorb new participation. Otherwise, I think we're really asking them to do what they can't do.
Thank you very much. A comment on that, Stephen?
Yeah. I just wanted to thank you for that comment. I just wanted to sort of add on to some of the thoughts that came up during the discussion. I think when we talk about sport participation, another thing that is going through my head at this point is that it's, you know, the paper was very good. The authors are clearly very good, but you always ask, well, what are the delimitations of the study? You know, we have a situation. We had an athletics event, and the other event was judo. So what is the inspiration of that event? There's all the planning that goes ahead of it. What's the call to action afterwards? Is there a straightforward plan afterwards in order to engage people at the participant level rather than focusing on the high performance level? I think we all understand that there's a symbiotic relationship from playground to podium. But we also have to try and understand or try to gauge or measure what are the competing sports? Why didn't we have participation? Was it, you know, created events like Tough Mudder taking away from people that are interested in being active as a result of having these events but have chosen, you know, things that are cooler or do a better job of advertising themselves? Is it simply dollars? Is it simply the fact that there are kids interested as a result of this, but they can't get away from daycare, their parents can't take them, there's no, you know, access usually with sport events because there's a legacy of buildings? That's usually not the case, but sometimes it may be. You know, we have a Canadian Tire Centre out in the middle of Kanata. If that was the only rink, there'd be a lot of people from Ottawa, a lot of kids from Ottawa that even if they could afford to play hockey, would have a tough time getting out here. So those are always, you know, questions. And then, as the paper indicates, sometimes it's just strategic failure. So I guess I would stress that if the academic community can make itself as present as possible and continue to bring up this issue, I think it would be very, very good for the sector as a whole.
Thank you, Stephen. I think that's a good way to wrap this presentation. Thank you, Marika, and to our three panel members. Alors, oui, une bonne main d'applaudissements. Merci.